As Garrett said, this is a double portion, but we're going to be concentrating on the Bahar section. The land was to have a sabbatical year of rest every 7 years. Verse 2 specifically of this whole section says specifically, the land itself must observe a Shabbat to the Lord. Ultimately, this is why Israel was carried away into captivity years later, because they didn't give the land rest as God had commanded. Once again, Hashem is asking the people to trust him, as in the Exodus from Egypt, provision in the desert, and on multiple occasions before. God promised to provide the people in the years the land was resting. Verse 21 says, then I will order my blessing to you on the sixth year. Notice he blesses the people, not the land. But the land will be blessed by an abundant harvest, enough to last for 3 years. Every 50 years was a year of Jubilee, and it was essentially an economic reset. Land was to return to the original owner. No sowing or reaping was permitted. They were to consume only volunteer plants from the previous year. In verse 23, God says the land belongs to him and not the people. They were, in essence, tenants and foreigners of the land. The land was not to be sold in perpetual ownership, but was to revert back to the original owner in the year of Jubilee. The value of the crop on the land was determined the price of the property, and was prorated according to how many crops and what the going rate was for that crop. Neither party was to take advantage of the other. Remember, God demands an honest balance and fair dealings. Love your neighbor as yourself. As an aside, in 1960, the Israel Lands Authority passed a law stating that the state and the Jewish national lands shall not be sold, but remain in perpetuity a possession of the state of Israel. So at least I got that right. And so by 1968, the state agencies hold 92% of the land in Israel. You can go, I looked online, and you can buy some pieces like in Galilee and small pieces, but in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, no, you can lease it, but you can't buy it. The backstory of the Haftorah, Jeremiah had a hard row to hoe. That's why he's called the weeping prophet. It says, the Lord tells Jeremiah not to marry, to have a family, as a sign of what he's about to bring on Israel. He's not to socialize, go to funerals, or take part in any festivities. He's going to be a homebody and not go out. The people couldn't see a problem and were asking what they'd done wrong. Jeremiah tells them they've outdone their fathers in following the stubbornness of their evil hearts instead of obeying God, and predicts the Babylonian captivity. They would be repaid double for all their wickedness because they defile the land. After giving the bad news to the people about the consequences of their actions, Jeremiah turns to God and in psalm-like fashion cries out, O Lord, my strength, my fortress, my refuge in time of distress. Judah's sin is etched with an iron tool on the tablets of their hearts. God would give away everything they'd held dear. Through your own fault, you will lose the inheritance that I gave you. I will enslave you to your enemies in a land you do not know, for you have kindled my anger, and it will burn forever. God's talking about your heart and my heart. The scripture says, Thou, O Lord, Thou, O Lord, search the heart and the reins. God knows my heart better than we know it. As God knows what deception is there, and it's easy for us to become deceived. It's easy for us to follow vain philosophy. It's easy for us to take the adage, the end justifies the means. And so our means become perverse, crooked, and selfish. This section is a good example of Hebrew poetry as a thought for thought comparison rather than, you know, rhyming in, you know, roses are red, violets are blue. You know, in English we have rhyming, and in Hebrew poetry they have thought for thought. The New Covenant reading centers on the account of Yeshua rebuking Peter. In the last year of his ministry, Yeshua had just revealed to the disciples that he must go to Jerusalem to suffer, be crucified, and raised from dead. Impetuous Peter always thought he knew better and he had a better ending to how the play should go. Peter was unaware that Satan was using him to turn Yeshua from his divine destiny. Everyone who would follow Messiah would pay the price for turning their back on the world. Ultimately, the reward would be given to all in accordance with their actions. All three of these scriptures have in common one thread: doing things God's way instead of following our natural inclinations. How many of us have bought something and have the instruction sheet and just kind of ditched the instruction? I know how to put this together. And then after you've struggled with it for about 25 minutes, you look at the instruction sheet, and the first thing that you thought you didn't need to do was the thing you needed to do. So God, the scriptures are our owner's manual. So if you go back to the owner's manual and use that, it would be a whole lot better. God asks us to step out of our comfort zone into his glorious light, and in the end, it will be worth it. Shabbat shalom.